You're out in the ocean in 25-foot seas and gale winds. Your life is in danger. Find out about the men who risk their lives every day to save yours and how you may have avoided that situation. Next on Captain's Log.
So, this is Captain's Log with your host, Captain Mark Gray. Welcome aboard.
Ventura Harbor Village is a colorful waterfront complex with over 40 varieties of shops, international cuisine, and even a nostalgic carousel just for fun. Whether you take a harbor cruise or just watch the fishermen unload their catch of the day, it's a great place for the whole family. Ventura Harbor Village, located on Spinnaker Drive in the Ventura Harbor. Public docks are available for those coming by boat.
Our guest is Master Chief Ken Fish, United States Coast Guard. Give us a brief boating history, if you would, you know, personal boating history.
Certainly. I've been in the Coast Guard for 19 years. I've served aboard several Coast Guard cutters, ships. I've served at 5 search and rescue stations, 2 of which I've been officer in charge, dealing with search and rescue and law enforcement. I was supervisor of a boating safety detachment, which dealt primarily with boating safety regulations and educating the public. And I'm currently officer in charge of the Coast Guard cutter Point Carew, which is a 82-foot patrol boat. Our primary mission is law enforcement and search and rescue.
So we would call you the captain of that?
In civilian terms.
Boat. Master Chief. Could you give us a brief history of the Coast Guard? I understand that's rather colorful.
Certainly. The Coast Guard was established in 1790 under Alexander Hamilton, the first treasurer of the United States. At that time, their function was to protect the revenues of the United States, or the colonies, I should say, from smugglers. We've evolved through the rum-running days, and in the early 1900s, we've merged with Life Saving Service, Lighthouse Service, and the Revenue Cutter Service to the present day Coast Guard. We're 37,000 men strong, men and women. Our current missions range from marine environmental protection, law enforcement, recreational boating safety, search and rescue, aids to navigation, ice breaking, and there's several others. One least note about the Coast Guard is we are an armed forces of the United States, and we've served in all wars, including starting with the French-American War. The Coast Guard cutter Harriet Lane fired the first shot of the Civil War.
Ah, that's interesting.
A lot of things that people just, you know.
I mean the first naval shot.
The first naval shot.
To clarify that,
I think there's something about
Fort
that's
Sumter
right.
or something.
That's right. And, as a result, I believe we're the oldest continuous naval service in the United States. And we're the primary maritime enforcement authority.
What portion of your time would you say is spent rescuing boaters and catering to that aspect of all of your chores?
Well, search and rescue usually takes precedence when it happens. And regardless of whether we're on an enforcement patrol or other duties, we drop what we're doing, obviously, and that comes first. And that usually takes up 50% of our time.
What always amazes me is, and I think you might agree, when you're called out on the most amount of rescues, everything happens all at once. You know, it's usually a bad weather day, such as Memorial Day past, and everyone needs help at the same time. And what really amazes me is that you guys would go out there in the worst of weather and actually rescue other people and do it consistently and successfully. Is this attributed to your maintenance program that you have for the boats?
Yeah, it's attributed to training and maintenance. Without a strict preventative maintenance program, your equipment would not function when you need it to function as often as you need it to function. And as an end result, the people that need help wouldn't get help.
Well, say that I'm a private boater, right? I would like to use the same system that you use to keep your boats up in top-notch shape. Mm-hmm. And yet, you know, let's look at it from a standpoint of a person that's never had a boat before. They just bought a power sailboat. Mm-hmm. Where can they go and develop a program like that? And what should they do?
I think there's several areas that they can research. The first thing that they might want to start with is their owner user manual. That's a good beginning.
Oh, pardon?
Their operator's manual.
Oh, yeah.
Is certainly a good beginning, and I'm sure that they're going to need other information, though. Other good sources through education courses, they often touch on preventative maintenance programs. Good source of information are other experienced boaters, as well as local marine dealers.
I would imagine a good starting place might be, and not like in searching for an attorney or a doctor, mm-hmm. perhaps you don't want to go to only one. Go to three or four or five boat yards and ask them for what they have in the way of a preventative maintenance
program.
That's
right.
Talk to 10 or 20 or 100 boaters.
Sure.
Go to the Coast Guard and the different area, places, and actually talk to them. Do you have MRC cards, maintenance requirement cards?
Yes, we do. We have a similar system. We call it, MRC cards or PMS cards, we call them, preventative maintenance service.
Right. Which shows the date and what should be looked at and done.
How to do it, what's to be done, and how often.
How much time it takes.
And we've got reports that we have to send in because the boss makes sure that they're done. And it's a Coast Guard-wide system.
Right. I believe we could probably make a lot of the boaters out there that do get into trouble eliminate that probably with good maintenance programs and, of course, the training and education.
Of the 60,000 or more calls a year that we respond to for assistance, over 55% of those are for disabled vessels.
I see. What would you say the most common occurrence is? Do people need a tow or what would it be?
Right.
Injury?
Of the calls that we get, over 55% are for boats 16 foot to 25 foot. Of those, some 57% to 67% are disabled for one reason or another and require a tow. And that's generally the bulk of our caseload.
Let's look at that under a little microscope
Sure.
here. The disabled boats, are they out of gas? Did the engine fail due to improper maintenance?
There is a percentage that do run out of gas, which is shouldn't normally happen to the experienced boater, somebody that takes the extra few minutes to check his equipment and his boat over before he goes on a trip. That really shouldn't be a problem, but however, it does occur. And with a boat, it's not like your automobile. When you run out of gas, you can pull to the side of the road, walk down to the gas station. That, you don't have that convenience.
Of course, if they have an inflatable blown up with an engine, it might help,
That may mean the difference in unfortunate circumstances.
Right. But again, as you know, transferring fuel out at sea, especially in rough seas, could be hard.
It's a difficult task.
We're out of time, and I would like to say we have Boshan Moshan, Boating Fashion in Motion, next.
Blending comfort, performance, and value, Catalina Yachts continue a tradition of building outstanding sailboats in every class. Sail the Catalina 30 and experience the successful combination of a modern, efficient hull shape with spacious accommodations that create the perfect balance in a modern racer cruiser. America's largest sailboat manufacturer invites you to call a Catalina Yacht dealer in your area today.
Time for Boshan Moshan. That's Boating Fashion in Motion with Miss Donna Russell, Ventura Bikini. Tell us, Donna, how did you start the Ventura Bikini shop?
Well, Mark, to tell you the truth, my son started it, Jimmy, And yes, we just really had a need here in Ventura for a custom, and I think he was tired of taking his girlfriend all over looking for a bathing suit for her, and that's what gave him the idea.
Good mom to do it.
Yes, well, it then he pulled me in.
Seems to be working very well for you, and I wish you the most of luck. And now it's on with the show.
Thank you, Mark. Our first model is Rose Simmons. She's wearing clothes. She's wearing a club wrap sweatshirt in the turquoise. She's wearing Sierra Pacific shorts. This sweatshirt comes in many different colors. Nice 100% cotton on the sweatshirt and the shorts. Very good colors for Rose. Thank you. Our next model is Kevin McKellum. He's wearing club shorts and he's wearing a Ventura bikini shirt. He's wearing the lavender and the pink ant print on the bottom, pair of flojos. These are very comfortable, all in 100% cotton. Thank you, Kevin. And our next model is Dana Russell. She's wearing one of our new French bathing suits. Very nice, stays in place. This also comes in black with the pink contrasting trim. This top can be worn three different ways. It can be worn as the bandeau, it can be worn as a triangle top, and also a halter top. Thanks, Dana. And our last model is Cherie Bouchard. She's wearing a LeBlanc suit. It's in the contrasting with the pink, the turquoise, and the yellow. Very nice high cut with the V in the front on the bandeau. Good fitting back. Even with the bandeau, this really stays in place. Good for action. Thank you, Cherie. And back to you, Mark.
Well, thank you, Donna. I appreciate that. We're back with Master Chief Ken Fish of the United States Coast Guard. Well, could you give us an idea, sir, of what a normal day's caseload might be, but normal for you in the sense of a bad weather day, such as last Memorial Day?
Well, on Memorial Day, between San Diego and Point Conception, Southern California, we prosecuted about 31 separate cases.
By prosecute, do you mean?
Prosecute worked or responded to calls for assistance.
I thought they were drug smugglers or something, you know.
Well, we do that,
quite a
too.
Bit.
Within those 31 cases, 18 of those were disabled vessels. Two of those, I believe, were hoaxes. We had one man overboard and two capsizings and several other, you know, other conditions.
I understand they had, I was monitoring the radio and they had a ship named Popeye. It was a large sailing vessel with a small engine, not strong enough to push the boat through the wind or against the wind, and they're being blown backwards?
Right. He could found himself in weather that he wasn't prepared for nor experienced for, and Murphy's Law, one thing led to another. He ended up with being unable to stem the tide, so to speak. He couldn't handle the winds that prevailed. His small engine wouldn't do the job, and they eventually tore his sails as well. Mm. And he pretty much had to throw his hands up in the air and call for help.
And usually by the time they call for help, it's long overdue.
Yes, sir, it is. A lot of times if they would call initially, we can sometimes give them advice ahead of time and lessen the degree of distress.
I did hear one call that day also where people were trying to get into the harbor and there were, I don't know, I believe 8-foot waves or something. Seas were about 8 feet. And I heard the Coast Guard telling them, well, when the wave comes at you, aim up into it about a 45-degree angle, and then when you're on top, fall off and try to make it in a little bit and keep doing that. And it's when the people are very tense and nervous, it seems hard for them to comprehend what they're doing. They should seek out training and what have you prior.
Yeah, that's correct. When the weather builds, the sea can be unforgiving, particularly around an inlet such as Channel Islands, Ventura. The swells build rapidly. An inexperienced boater will find himself in an unfortunate circumstance real quickly. That's something we can't teach them over the radio very well, how to maneuver their boat. It's usually late by that time. They should not put themselves in the predicament to begin with.
But if they find themselves there, which can happen, as you can tell, the wind is building today, which living here, we know this is normal. Uh-huh. The haze burn off, right. We have beautiful sunshine in the afternoon, right. And a little breeze. But if you're not familiar with the weather patterns, and even if the predominant weather patterns can change real fast. So where could someone get a little additional meteorology training, perhaps?
They can take courses through the Coast Guard Auxiliary and their local power squadron. They all have basic boating courses, which include meteorology training, weather training.
And do you have another incident on that day that we were talking about? Bayliner, I believe?
We had a 22-foot Bayliner that ventured out early that morning. There was five people on board. They were off of Point Magoo Rock. Their day started out pretty routinely for them, going out to have a good time. The well, they're built on them. The wind picked up from 47 knots constant to 54 knot gusts.
In miles per hour, could you explain to our non-boating viewers about what that would be?
Okay, 54 knot gusts is probably around 49 miles an hour.
That's quite a bit of wind.
That's
out there.
Moving along. That's
no close trees. To, no trees to break it
that's
down.
That's correct, and that's close to hurricane strength. They found themselves in 25-foot seas in a 22-foot boat. To worsen their predicament, they lost power to their engine. And in an effort to restart the engine, they drained a battery, which left them with no communications. A passing fishing vessel did, however, come by and give assistance. They stood by, relayed the distress to the Coast Guard, which enabled us to respond. We were unable to get the people off initially because we felt it was too dangerous at the time due to the sea conditions. So we put a man aboard ourselves, put the vessel in tow. However, once night fell, the weather billed, and the boat began to take on water and break apart. So we had no choice but to go alongside and try to pull the people up. One man did go into water and we retrieved him safely. So it was an unfortunate outcome in this case.
Well, you sure can get in trouble quick out there, and it pays to be as experienced as you can be. I suggest to people before they buy a boat to get training, but you and I both know it works in the reverse. They buy the boat, they're out there every weekend at the islands, and then they go for training. And that's what we'll be talking about in later shows, Power Squadron Coast Guard Auxiliary. I thank you. This is Captain's Log. We'll be back with Sea Tales next.
Marina sailing, experience it, the vacation of a lifetime. Islands to explore, sheltered coves to discover, clear water to enjoy. You say you don't know how to sail? Well, that's okay, because we've been teaching people to sail for over 25 years. In fact, we're California's oldest and largest sailing club with 70 boats and 3 locations to serve you. Come on down, take the challenge. We're Marina Sailing.
Please welcome my guest for Sea Tales, Judge Albert T. Blanford of the United States Power Squadron. It's nice having you on the show, sir.
Very nice to be here, Mark.
I understand that you, over your years of experience, I'm sure you have dozens and dozens of good sea tales to tell, with true stories with a safety message. Could you just tell us one or two?
Yes, one story that really comes to mind is a story that happened about 15 years ago. I had a very good friend by the name of Phil who I played golf with. We worked together, and he decided to buy a small sailboat, a small 20-foot day sailor, and he didn't know the first thing about sailing, and he enlisted a friend of ours by the name of Doug, who had some experience, how much I don't really know. But in any event, they took off here from Channel Islands Harbor about 15 years ago, and for a cruise over to Anacapan back that day, they had no radio aboard. They started out with a third person aboard, as the trip progressed and they got out on the middle of the channel, the wind started coming up, as it frequently does around here. And after they were a little over halfway across, the metal mast broke. Mm. And so they're, first of all, faced with the problem of trying to get things in order. And all they had was an outboard motor. And they made the first decision, which was to continue on over to Anacapa rather than to return here to the harbor. Why they made that decision, I don't really know. I talked to Doug, who, by the way, was the sole survivor of the three afterwards, a few days after, and he wasn't really sure why they made that decision, or at least I wasn't sure after talking to him. It was probably because of the sea conditions and the wind. I assume it was an east wind at that time. And maybe they made the right decision, I don't know. But in any event, they decided to go on over to Anacapa Island. And by this time, the winds were, I'm sure, in excess of 30 miles. It was a full gale, probably, by this mm-hmm. time. They arrived in the area of Frenchies on this side of the island. And again, they made another decision, that is to anchor on the north side of the island rather than go around to the other side, where if in an east wind, there's a better anchorage over there. But again, why the decision was made or so forth, I don't know. But anyway, they did make the decision to anchor on that side. And as they're sitting there at anchors, preparing to, I guess, to get something to eat, the anchor started dragging. Mm. They were unable to keep the boat from being bashed up against the cliff there on Anacapa Island. The boat began breaking apart. All three of them were thrown into the water. They did have life jackets.
That's incredible that this could go on unchecked. In other words, I always tell people it's a good idea to always have someone on watch. You know, a lot of people want to sail around the world by themselves or with two people. If it's your first experience, which a lot of people do think,
yeah, oh, yes.
You know, you should have ample people.
Mark, I think part of the problem was the place they anchored was not a good anchorage, mm-hmm. especially for the strength of the winds at
right.
the time.
I'm and they sure. may not have put out enough road or
probably
line to get the proper scope or angle.
That's right. There wasn't enough road out to the scope. But again, those details I don't know. I wasn't there. But in any event, it began dragging and the boat ended up bashed against the rocks. It broke apart. They all got thrown in the water and Doug was able to scramble aboard on the cliff. Oh. And was unable to assist the other two. And Hugh and Phil, my good friend, were swept away by the sea. And
right there, almost near shore.
Oh, yeah.
They just got swept out to sea and couldn't make it in.
Yeah,
and
Doug was, as I say, had acquired a perch on the side of the cliff. And he was unable to reach them. He told me he tried to throw out, he took out his life jacket, threw, mm-hmm. you know, out, tried to.
Did they all have jackets
on? They all had jackets on, but of course the wind was blowing.
And it just carried them off like a sail.
It carried them off, that's right. Mm-hmm. And,
and
you can't blame Doug. He didn't want to jump back in that sea, and you can't blame
him. Well, he probably wouldn't be here to tell the story.
That's right. He wouldn't be here if he had done that.
So people do have to use discretion.
The thing is, there's several morals you can draw from this. The first is, never go out there without a marine radio.
And perhaps a handheld radio for emergencies.
Yes, any kind of a marine radio where if you get in a situation where it's beyond your control, you hopefully can reach the Coast Guard and get some assistance. Probably if they were able to radio the Coast Guard when their mast first broke, they might have gotten assistance and they'd
that's,
all be
That's another thing.
Today.
Contact the Coast Guard before it becomes an emergency. A lot of people think it has to be a mayday.
The other thing is, this channel can be very treacherous. You should never go out there if there's any indication of other than just good normal weather. We're recreational boaters. We're not professional seamen. And you just shouldn't do it. If there's any indication of bad weather, you should just not go out. The other thing is that so many people buy boats. They don't really have any experience at the sea, out at sea. They don't know how dangerous it can be. And it's a very good idea to get some instruction in the subject. The Coast Guard Auxiliary, as I'm sure you're aware, holds public classes, and the Power Squadrons also have public boating courses.
And we'll be going over that right on a few shows coming up here. This has been Captain's Log saying, be safe and watch Captain's Log. So thank you.